like you hate it now, but wait till you drive it.
The Kibbe and Friends Show.
What it is, bro?
Presented by Holley Performance, makers of the world's best air and fuel delivery systems. Featuring Rob Kibbe.
I don't know how to put this, but kind of a big deal.
Justin Corndog Cornette.
New guy's in the corner puking his guts out.
And show producer Bernie McPartland.
This is the DJ 3000, and it has three distinct varieties of inane chatter.
We're talking cars.
Do you feel this vehicle is safe for highway travel?
Yes, I do.
Diving deep on the topics that matter most.
Just when I think you couldn't possibly be any dumber, you go and do something like this.
And totally redeem yourself!
And the Dukes of Hazzard. Available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and wherever you get your content.
Turn up the volume.
This is the Kibbe and Friend Show.
Kibbe and Friend Show, episode number 269. Available in Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Play, Pandora, iHeartRadio, Instagram, the YouTube, and Patreon. I am your host, Rob Kibbe, period. Corndog would have said something by now. With me, as always, is not co-host Justin Corndog Cornette, but temporary fill-in co-host Cody Young of Cody Crafted of YouTube fame. Welcome, Cody.
Oh, well, thank you for having me.
You are.
Period.
Period. End of- And excellent. And in the glass booth of emotion with his guns, his bacon, and his Cadillacs. No guns today. Producer Bernie McPartland. Welcome, Bern.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for, I guess, letting everyone know the tables have been turned. You know, Corndog's not the boss, it turns out. Turns out the code man is the boss. He's fired everybody, and he's here to claim his territory, sit upon his throne, exact his will, ornament his hood. Join us.
Yes. I think the real boss is not here, because you know who the boss is by the one who doesn't show up, and the job so gets done. Our man Corndog went to do some quote-unquote parenting to watch his kids play quote-unquote baseball. And I don't know what bad habits he does have other than like buying stuff and never selling it, but I'm sure that he's actually out doing bad habits. Cody, thank you for filling in tonight. You're going to do the whole show with us.
It's absolutely my pleasure. And as Bernie knows, I never exhausted for options.
Yes.
True that.
How's your Chevelle sounding?
It sounds great, man.
It didn't fall off and like drag like Uncle Buck or anything?
I had one issue where the passenger side turned down at the very back by the back quarter panel, kind of nosed its way back up. And so it was kind of rattling against the quarter panel down there, kind of didn't know what it was. And so I got down there with a persuader and just kind of bent things around a little bit. And now it's fine.
I'm pretty sure we used a jack handle to dial that in the first time. So, you know, it is what it is.
It is what it is. It's awesome.
For those of you who are new, this is your automotive and pop culture break from reality. This will be a different one. Cody, I think, has a beverage. Cody and Bernie are both in Texas. I knew we were in Texas when I took the General Lee to Cody's shop, and Bernie walked in, having never met Cody, and said, "Hey, Cody, I need to put this somewhere," and held up his personal armament. And Cody said, "Why, of course.
In here with the rest.
Place it over here with these."
You're welcome to hide it in the safe with the rest of them. And that way they don't get lonely. Or if you feel like you might need it, you can just leave it on top of the fridge. And then let's take this box-o-box and make sure they don't get lonely either.
Another beer, anyone?
Yes. Yes.
Everybody, here's what we're going to do today. One of Cody's favorite movies is a movie called Hot Rod. And it stars Andy Samberg. And it stars many people, but Andy Samberg would be the lead. We've been wanting to review this movie for a long time. It is not a car movie. It is a stunt movie, though, and it's a very funny stunt movie. That's our tie-in. We're going to review that movie, and he knows this movie, and he knows it well. So he offered to step in when the review was time, whenever that review day would come, and today's the day. So we're going to do that later here. But Cody owns a shop, and he runs his own YouTube channel in addition to running a shop. So let's just start there. Cody, you've been in business for a few years now, right?
Yes, sir.
And you're not out of business yet. And you've expanded into a new shop. Got some people?
I got some people. I've had some people come. I've had some people go. And I've got some people now that hopefully they don't plan on going anywhere because they're the the people I've been looking for.
What do you specialize in at Cody Crafted?
As you are aware, we are in the cool shit business. That is what we do.
There's one edit.
I can run that back. That's fine.
No. Three new customers just signed up. There's a little... Well, I would like that.
No, Rob, as you are aware, even in the new building, we are building cool stuff. That is BCS, build cool stuff.
Yes.
That's what we do.
Not necessarily specific to any one genre. You'll work on hot rods, 4x4s, American, Japanese. You don't really seem to care, right? I mean, like, anything cool is good with you.
Yeah. I tell everybody that I don't build stance cars and I don't touch bro-dozers. But other than that, I'm pretty open to just about anything. So we recently had a T-bucket with a Gen 1 392 Hemi. And next to it in the shop is a 7.3 ton and a half ambulance that we converted to four-wheel drive on 37-inch tires.
Yes.
So, yeah. K5s. I had five square bodies in the shop at one point a couple weeks ago. So, I mean, yeah, we just work on all kinds of fun stuff.
This is a Holley sponsored show, so we'll get to the plug later. Do you do a lot of EFI conversions or like swaps or like what's a bread and butter job for you?
We do a fair bit of EFI conversions. We do snipers. We do Terminator stealths. Mm-hmm. We do LS swaps, usually using the Terminator ECUs. I've even done them on 5.0s with the Terminator ECUs, converting them from speed density and mass air Mustang stuff over to with 30-year-old wiring harnesses, and pretty much all that Ford Terminator stuff plugs right in. You change like two sensors and everything else just plugs straight in to the Mustang 5.0 stuff. So it's pretty cool. And then you have the same integration stuff as you would with a Terminator on an LS. So that part's pretty cool.
You have a background in racing. When I've described you to people, I've said you're like a hired gun. You'd be brought in, you work for a race team for a weekend, you do whatever needs to be done, you leave.
Yeah, did that for a couple of years. I had a few gigs at home and some steady work at home, but for a couple of years we did IHRA, NHRA drag racing back in the early 2000s for a couple of different pro mod teams. Also wound up in like the 09, 2010 through 2015 or so, a lot of racing for road racing. So Grand Am Cup, World Challenge, won a championship with an ALMS team, ran Mustangs, ran Camaros, a bunch of spec Miatas, a couple of prototype cars, Star Mazda stuff. You know, hired gun. Go in, fly out on Wednesday, work 18 hours, sleep in hotels with multiple dudes in the same room, and, you know, try to get the car on track and make it as good as you can. And then Sunday, load the hauler and fly back home. It was fun at the time. Not a family man's gig, so now we're doing this.
How's the YouTube channel going?
YouTube channel's growing. It seems like views are down across the board, according to some of the research that we do in trying to maximize analytics and stuff for the channel. I've had a couple of people in some of the groups that we're in on Facebook YouTuber groups and this, that, and the other. And my editor's in a couple of other groups, too. And they're like, oh, you know, things have just stagnated. We haven't fallen. Our growth has slowed, but we're not losing subscribers. We're not losing watch time. It's just not growing as fast as it was over the winter. Bunch of people are saying it's the economy. It's this, it's that. I think it's just summertime and people are outside. They've got soccer games. They've got swimming practice. They've got kids to go on vacation.
Yeah.
And it's not dark and cool. And people aren't sitting around watching YouTube on Sunday mornings. They're up and mowing the yard. Maybe I'm simplistic in that, but I know I got a lot more going on with the kids out of school and stuff. So.
It's funny you mentioned that, because if I'm lucky, one Saturday a month, I will get like 45 minutes of alone YouTube time. We just have a smart TV. On Saturday morning, it gives me the best videos. And by 8 o'clock in the morning, the videos that it suggests are all like for my kids. Like it knows. It knows
really
everything. That's when I'll see your stuff. That's when I'll see Jeff Allison's stuff. That's when I'll see the airplane stuff I like. And by 8, it's throwing up stuff like with watch a dream, play this game. And I mean, it's just all this weird stuff that it knows my kids search on by 8 a.m.
So my kids, my two boys, they have another profile that's under there. And it's actually one of my other profiles that I was using. You know, once we created the channel, we made one for the channel. We actually just switched profiles. And so the kids only watch their stuff on that one. And I watch mine on mine. And so that way I don't have to see the it's 6 million things, but it's Minecraft.
Yes.
So,
well, we could do that, but I'm not smart enough, apparently, or I guess I like to spy on them to know what they're searching for. Anyway.
I definitely make sure that I watch what they're watching, but I don't need to see 100 layers of whatever. That's not my jam.
Okay, Bern, cue the special announcement music. Do you have the music?
Oh, yeah, right here, okay, right here.
Good. Breaking news.
Big news. Not even Corndog hears this one first, unless he remembers it from Patreon. The Kibbe and Friend Show is once again the official media sponsor of the General Lee Jump at MOParty 2023.
Just a good old boy.
Yes. Yes. You betcha.
This is a big deal because this comes with A, the ability to pimp an event we would have pimped anyway, and B, the ability to get our name on kick-ass banners everywhere so that C, we can steal them before the crowd does.
That's right. This time, the thievery will start early.
Yes. We now That's know right. when to steal.
As soon as we get there,
we're
baby.
Going to.
Oh, I got to have things to sign. I mean, I'm running out of babies to sign.
Now, I would love to have our whole gang there. So we've talked about the Kibbe and Friends text chain many times. You are one of the, if not the worst offender on it, of starting things, Cody, that maybe shouldn't be started, but are certainly enjoyable. And end in shame or disgust. But are you available to go to MOParty? Could you make it happen?
You're going to have to remind me of the dates, Robert.
Sorry. September 15th through 17th, in fact.
I was trying to segue there.
That was a good segue. September 15th through 17th in Bowling Green, Kentucky at Beach Bender Raceway.
Well, according to the calendar that my wife and I share, we have an event that weekend that's a prior engagement, unfortunately.
Uh-huh. Okay.
I will do my best to get out of it.
Thank God. Okay. So... Last year, we had a pretty good turnout. It was a hoot. I will say we had a terrific time. That is the big announcement here. The other big announcement here is Sam Urban, who lovingly has donated us this old Lincoln Town Car. I would love to find a way to get it there by MOParty so that we can, I don't know, put it on two wheels or ruin it or something. He has let me know since our Patreon show release, the car is not drivable, not more than 10 minutes or so. It doesn't have enough parts on it. You said it'll overheat by the time you get that far into it. So don't.
Rob, I can jump anything once.
That's what she said.
Right. You can. We're looking for friends that might be able to help us get this car from Dubuque down to Bowling Green. We'll figure it out from there. There are some events that happen at Beach Bend with Holly over the winter. And I can't recall the name of them, but it's basically kind of like winter ice smash 'em up derby type stuff.
Ooh. That sounds fun.
That would also be fun as well. So if you are in the Midwest area and you might be going by the city of Dubuque, Iowa, between now and September 15th, let us know. We would love to find a way to make this happen. You can join us on Patreon. Just go to patreon.com/KF Show. Sam is a member of Patreon, and that is where he contacted us about this town car to try to give us. We were initially going to try to generally it and do what Jamie Smith does and like, it's not quite the same wheelbase as we thought. Danny Atkinson was right on that one. But we still would love to just ruin it, as would Sam. And Sam would like to see it ruined for a good reason, because it's only worth scrap if he doesn't. God bless him. Patreon.com/KF Show is where you go if you'd like to join in on the fun there. Evan Winterstein was the most deserving listener this past month because he likes muscle tractors. And that's all it takes.
That is a cool phrase. Muscle tractors. Yeah. Muscle bound, you have muscle lips, I've heard, muscle head, muscle car, muscle tractor. That's just another great addition to that muscle library. I don't know if you get muscle feet, get lobbed into that. If you get
a lot of things there. You don't want to Google, Bern.
That's true. That's where my mind was drifting. So I said, I better stop that right there.
Love muscle is probably the one you don't want to do.
I avoided that one on purpose. On purpose.
With all of that said, with our man Corndog not here, there's no stupid game. There will be no stupid games. They're not stupid.
They're not stupid.
They're just not right now. They're just not right now. What we can do is go to the other sponsor segment in this show. Now, Cody, you've heard of the Bernie on the News segment. Tell me straight.
I believe there's a billboard on I-35 right next to my shop about it, if I'm not mistaken.
Do you enjoy the Bernie on the News segment? Be honest.
I'm trying to find the words that express how much I enjoy the Bernie on the News segment.
On a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being I love it, 1 being I don't love it, where would you land?
I would give Bernie on the News 8 Cadillac trunks full of ammunition.
Wow. Wow. You do like Bernie on the News.
Awesome. Thanks, man.
Speak each other's love language.
And they're not even reloads. It's new stuff.
New stuff. Yeah.
That's right. Not gun show reloads.
Well, with that said, somebody paid for this segment. And while there is some news in here, national and internationally, burn things is worth knowing. Cody seems to enjoy it. Maybe I'm the only hater here, but world, it's your party, not mine. This is the award-winning, self-awarded segment by Bernie for Bernie called Bernie on the News. Take it away, Bernie.
For the news sponsored by the staff at National Parts Depot, by the way, serving us in the hobby for over 40 years. Yes. You guys, especially Cody, you've heard this. You've heard the sound of rust. You've heard it. You can hear it when you walk by your project car and you pause. The voice in your head runs through the list of things you really need to get to. And if not for that thing you got to do right now, you do it. As you exhale a brief regret, you hear it. You hear the sound of rust. Just a little chink in the armor, almost undetectable except for your expert ear. So now the ball is in your court. Your to-do list will never get shorter, but the rust bunnies grow larger and larger. When the lights go off tonight in the garage and in the shop, they will roar and they will gaff as they consume the metal buffet that you have provided them until you take action. Stop. Be like Kibby. Kill the bunnies.
One rabbit stew coming right up.
And start your parts exploration today at 800-874-7595, npdlink.com. They find, they source, they stock the best. There is a difference, and they, NPD, they got the goods.
They move a lot of sheet metal.
They do.
Sheet, yeah, they do.
He was listening 2 weeks ago when I did that bit.
Rick has told me how many containers they have on the ocean at any one time, and it's a hard-to-believe number. I mean, it's like 15? 10 or 15?
That's a lot of sheet metal.
I think I remember that conversation.
I think I'm remembering that, right? More than I've ever. I've done one for an order once. And to date, that's still the one. They move a lot of sheet metal.
Good people. Thank you, NPD. Well, since you get your car parts sometimes in brown boxes from brown trucks, you should be happy that UPS and the Teamsters Union have, in fact, reached a tentative deal on a new contract. It's been called a win-win-win by both sides. Included is compensation for part-time UPS workers. Now make $21 an hour. Pretty respectable. Plus an hourly raise of $275, I think, for existing employees. That means full-timers now average $49 an hour after the contract goes in place. And your packages...
Sorry, I'm closing my shop.
You are? You're going UPS?
Yeah, I'm going UPS.
I'll take it.
I think you would look quite handsome, you know, in a very hetero way, I'm saying, in those brown shorts, driving a truck.
Well, the Magnum PI is the optimal length for performance.
Little wag, no sag, a lot of ventilation.
What?
You guys, like that one.
Sorry, you guys are talking Texas here. I'm lost.
But 1 year at Barrett Jackson, when we went out there, I got the opportunity to do something really, really cool. I got to interview drag racing legend Don Prudhomme. That was a great day. And here's one I would like to do also. The other legend in the sport, Don Garlitz. This from the NHRA. Don Garlitz is finishing up the screenplay for a documentary on his life. It's going to be very cool. Don Garlitz, it's called The Story of an American Legend. Estimated to be about 2 hours in length or so. And there have been other attempts at this through the years. 10, in fact. Other documentaries that have been trying to been made. But Don says he's never liked the scripts and is always a little bit cheesy. So he's going to do it all himself. All the writing and all the directing and everything. If you want a sneak peek for some of this, it's really cool. Some of the screenplay, they've got it posted at nhra.com. So you can kind of read through. If you don't know what a screenplay is, it's basically a script for a movie. And so you can kind of read through how they format those things and stuff. So some of that's posted there. Kind of cool. Hmm. The conversation must have gone something like this, I think. One guy. Hey, got 1,000 spare acres? Yeah? Can we build a theme park on it? Cool, thanks. Phone hangs up. So now, a 1,000-acre resort destination and a theme park that will cost more than $2 billion with a B is coming to a northeastern Oklahoma near you. The station KCCI News says this will be dubbed as an anchor location along the old Route 66 in the next few years, and ultimately it's going to be a 125-acre theme park with an American-themed environment with various rides, live shows, family attractions, waterways, restaurant-quality food, drinks, and an RV park to boot.
Have you guys done a Route 66 drive before? Even segments of it?
Yeah, actually, my mother grew up in a little town called El Reno, Oklahoma. You may know it from such classic movie scenes as the hotel bathtub from Rain Man.
Oh, yeah?
That is where they filmed, yes. And that is a little motel on Route 66.
No kidding.
And Route 66 runs right through the town of El Reno, Oklahoma. So we go there at least every year, if not multiple times a year, especially when I was a kid. So, yeah, I've been up and down Route 66 in various capacities. Many times.
Not many times, but now that we're kind of in the habit of driving out to the SEMA show, just carrying too much crap to fly anymore. You know, we hit portions of it from Amarillo out to New Mexico and stuff, and we stop and get some of the restaurants and things, some of the local fare. It's a lot of fun. There have been attempts, I think, through the years, they're trying to revive it, you know, and bring it up, but it's just hard to get to. You know, the movie starts ringing true. You still, while you're driving, you still want to save that 10 minutes and bypass the exit. But if you do, it's kind of cool.
We've done it again, bits and segments here. Mostly when I go there, though, I'm going to see the old abandoned kitsch stuff. You're lucky if there's still some stuff that's alive and good, like a theme park. If it's a good one, I could see that being an attraction. That would be a nice thing. I would love a reason to go to Route 66, but know that I could probably stay on Route 66 and not have to go back to like a real town, go to bed or go find food or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So it says it's just west of Grand Lake on Route 66 in northeastern Oklahoma, comparable in size to Disneyland or the Magic Kingdom at Disney World, American Heartland theme park.
Is it owned by Six Flags? I mean, somebody with money.
No, this type. No, it is not.
Man, interesting.
It is not. American Heartland is the name of the company.
Somebody's got some vision.
Yeah.
Time now for the pop culture section. That is the Kibbe and Friends study of dead people and other fun facts. Did you know August 1st, 1981? What happened on that day? Do you remember? Well, that's why I'm here to tell you. MTV hits cable systems nationwide.
Really?
With music television. Remember when it was all about music and not reality shows? Weren't those great days so good?
Who was the the super good looking girl VJ? Martha Quinn?
She was the girl next door with the black, you know, shoulder length haircut kind of thing.
Yeah.
And then the other one was Nina Blackwood, who does a kind of a rewind segment now. She doesn't sound as young as she used to.
Happens at the best of us.
Anybody remember what the very first video was played on MTV that midnight?
I do.
12:01 a.m. August 1st, 1981. What was it, Code?
It was Dire Straits. It was Money for Nothing and Your Chicks for Free.
Was it Video Killed the Radio Star?
Oh, yeah! Video Killed the
Radio Star. Good steal from the Kibbe.
Damn it.
Every now and then.
Do you know the name of the group?
I don't know the name of the group, but I only know it because it was in The Wedding Singer. I just really like that Adam Sandler movie.
Yeah. Name of the group was The Buggles, B-U-G-G-L-E-S. Mm. Video Kill the Radio Star.
Man. So, and I don't know because I was 1.5 at the time. Do you know, was that song already released or was it initially released on MTV?
I think it was released for MTV. I don't know the story that it was going to be the first one. I don't know the history behind that. As of last year, when we did this story, they were still touring now and again. Hmm.
I still remember the ad, like the one that's in the Ferris Bueller movie, like with the girl that takes the chainsaw and cuts the face off the TV and it says MTV inside the TV.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. I remember those. That's, I still remember that. Was awesome.
And they used to smash them.
Mm-hmm.
Well, enough of the fun stuff. Let's get on to the death, shall we?
Yes, please.
Bring out today.
According to SEMA, the founder and CEO of Callaway Cars has passed away. His name was Eli Reeves Callaway III. He founded the company in 1977. Among the first successful products was an aftermarket turbo kit for the BMW. Callaway is well known for his work with the Corvette, which helped deliver two industry firsts. That was the Callaway Twin Turbo Corvette B2K designation. The next one was the world record in 89 when Callaway Cars built a twin turbo Corvette. They call that one the Sledgehammer. That set a production car top speed of 254 miles an hour, 0.76. That record held until 2010.
I remember that car on Car and Driver, the Sledgehammer. That was such a big deal when that car came out. I saw that news when he passed away. Hard to realize. Everybody's getting older. Yeah, Reeves Callaway himself is gone. Mm-hmm. It's crazy.
A lot of people dead musically. Sinead O'Connor.
Sinbad O'Connor. Sinbad was from Saturday Night Live. He was Frank Sinatra. Sinbad O'Connor.
She was 56. Lost a big one in Tony Bennett. He passed away. He was 96 a few days ago. And George Tickner, he was the guitarist and one of the founding members of the band Journey, along with Neil Sean. He was 76 years old, and Neil, who of course played at one time with Carlos Santana in that group before Journey came together.
Hmm.
And the big one, Randy Meisner, one of the founding members of the Eagles, died of chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. His credits include playing in Linda Ronstadt's backup band at one time, along with two other people. Who were they? Oh, yes, Glenn Frey and Don Henley. They all went on to form the Eagles shortly after that. And the big one, the big, big, big one.
Yeah.
Pee-wee Herman has passed away.
Oh, man.
Just yesterday, I believe. Paul Rubens was 70 years old, responsible for at least of three of the most greatest junior high sayings ever. And since we're all kind of in that junior high at heart feeling here, mm-hmm. you know what they are by chance?
I know you are, but what am I?
That's one.
That's one of them.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Give me a hint.
That's my name. Don't wear it out.
Okay. And then the third one, like, I was not at that porn theater.
Yeah, I did not stand on that stage.
Never mind. What's the third one, Bert?
The third one and the biggie.
Why don't you take a picture? It'll last longer.
Hi, Jerry.
I never once saw a Pee-wee movie.
That's a shame. You got 2 hours you never want back in your life. Invest it.
I know him best from like his tiny, tiny part in Blues Brothers when he's the waiter at the restaurant and says,
we have a Dom Perignon 71 at $120.
That'll be fine, pal.
Wow. Yeah.
Good pull. Wow. Good pull.
That one is. That's solid.
Recent birthdays celebrating 80 is Mr. Mick Jagger. Celebrating 59 years, Sandra Bullock. Matt LeBlanc, he was one of the new Top Gears, wasn't he? Matt LeBlanc?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 56 years old.
England.
Couldn't even do it here. Wouldn't let him, I guess. Mark Cuban, speaking of Texas, 65 years old. And Wesley Snipes, 61 years old.
Still owes taxes.
Still owes taxes. Thank you, National Parts Depot. That is your news.
Good news, Bern.
Good news, Bern.
Thank you.
Interesting news today. Was there some automotive stuff in there? We got Route 66, Reeves Callaway.
Reeves Callaway.
Yeah.
A plethora of dead people.
Tony Bennett had a car, I'm sure.
I'm sure Tony had a couple of cars. Wesley Snipes drove a Charger and Blade.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's the tie-in. That was good news. Before we segue to the movie review, Dallas, my son Dallas, races in outlaw carts, and he's in the intermediate class. So this is a methanol alcohol class. The English Creek Nationals, just outside of Knoxville, Iowa, sprint car capital of the world. That is next Monday and Tuesday. We did a test and tune on Monday or Sunday. We've got it as dialed as in we could get, unless we just start cheating. And I'm just not interested in cheating. I want to try to win legit. But our season will basically be over.
You're no smoky eunuch.
Well, there's cheating and there's cheating. There's the cheating that says, thou shalt not run tire prep, so we don't. And then there's the other kind that says you need to have a wing and it can't be too big. Well, what's too big, right? There's minutia that we can negotiate there. But our season will basically be over here. How far are you guys from Wichita Falls? There's a track there that I'm interested
in. Like an hour.
Okay, it's called the Texoma Speedway, and they race outlaw carts there. The trick is it can't just race outlaw carts. They also have to race our class. And our class is probably one of the lesser popular classes because it's a methanol alcohol class, but it's typically called intermediate or intermediate wing. I was interested in that one because they race much later into the year. So if, Cody, we were ever able to do a five-speed swap in the General A, finally, I would love to bring the General down and bring the cart down, do a little racing while we're at it.
That would be fantastic. I will do everything in my power to be there.
I think that would be really fun.
Bernie and I could probably get there in an hour and a half or two.
Yeah. Maybe. Well, if we leave from your place, absolutely. Yeah.
It's a little west from... I used to do a lot of work in Wichita Falls. It's a little west of Wichita Falls, but it's up there in a good spot.
Okay. It looks fun to me. Pretty sure they run our class. I'm going to call them and confirm. But that's usually the trick, is finding somebody that runs the intermediate class. For those that do the stuff, it's up from box stop. It's also called builder prepared, but it's lower than like a 125 or a 250, something like that. Anyway.
There's a lot in Oklahoma City, a lot of dirt track.
Oh, we can do those too.
In and around Oklahoma City.
Hoping to get closer to Cody Crafted for that five-speed swap, because not shifting gears sucks, Cody. I've just determined this.
I wish you would get on with this because I need to see how this is done in your car so I can avoid all those mistakes when Cody and I do my car.
We're putting a drift brake in it too. Because
not doing
why put in a five speed if you're not going to put in a drift brake too?
You got to be able to jab the clutch and yank the stick, right? I mean, that's like hoon handle.
And the drift brake. Let's go ahead and get to the movie review presented by Holley. Now, good news here. Holley came out with a major press release last week. Holley has released the all-new Sniper 2.0. So the Sniper is it's the Kleenex of EFI swaps. I think that's probably the truth at this point. Everybody has had a chance to try a Sniper or get a Sniper or knows of the Sniper. Well, now it's the Sniper 2.0. So Cody, you have far more experience with Snipers than I do. I've never installed a Sniper in my life. More familiar with Terminators, more familiar with the MSD stuff, you know, from an install standpoint. So I don't know a lot about installing a Sniper. Corndog has a Sniper on his car. You've put on a bunch. The new 2.0 has come out. There's like four wired hookup. Or you can use, like, what's the plug-and-play system there? PDM? A power distribution model. So you can just plug everything into that if you need to.
Yes.
Have you looked at the new Sniper? Because there's like 14 new features in it. I've read the Holley press release. I'm actually going to watch the install video. It's like a 35-minute video. I don't understand how they can put enough engineering in this thing. I mean, they do it, but they put the engineering into it so that you can take this system to put it into any application. So some people will have a points distributor to hook up to it. Some people will have a factory setup. Some people will run full-time and control from Holley. They come up with every combinable option. You know, some people will have a turbo 350. Some people are going to have a 704. Somebody's going to have a C6 Ford transmission. That they have all of these different ways to hook this up. What's the difference between a four-wire hookup on this new one versus what you've dealt with in older Snipers? Just off the top of your head.
It is going to be a whole lot cleaner. And not that it's been super clustered by any stretch of the imagination, but the fact that all the wires come out of the same spot on the new one is pretty promising because it just makes it easier to kind of hide those wires. And the way it looks like it's set up, yes, I have not watched the full install video. I have watched a little bit of the videos on there. It looks like they've basically just simplified the harness and realized that most people are not using external controls because there was another plug that's pretty good size. I mean, it's like 1 inch by 2 inches and it's for all your like fan controls and your AC kick and all that kind of stuff. So what I would have to assume is they're kind of using, once again, I didn't go all the way through it, but it almost looks like they're using the CAN bus port in order to run the PDM. It's kind of what I'm thinking is going on. It does tell me you need a fuel pump wire, battery, ignition signal, and RPM, and then power and ground, which has pretty much always been the case. But the ignition setup was through a separate pigtail. The RPM signal could come in from two different ways, depending upon what ignition system you were running. The fuel pump had a integrated, like a relay and a fuse and all that stuff in it. So I can tell where, not that it was really cluttered looking before, but it's definitely a lot cleaner. I also like a little bit of design they did on the chipset, like the printed circuit. PCB, it's got, the older one has like a big plate, not really inviting to like look at what's going on inside there. not that you want to go in there and go fiddling around with stuff, but this does have a really like a nicer, more purposeful look to that side of the unit instead of just being kind of a slab that said sniper. This kind of has some casting marks in it and stuff, kind of makes it look a little more carburetor-y.
Yeah.
As opposed to the other one that was very obvious that there was something else going there.
You know, as I read through all the features, like there's nothing in here you would say, wow, I don't want that. But there's a couple that did stand out to me. So this one's a next generation ECU with RF noise and interference resistance.
That is a big deal.
Stands up to old car wiring, noisy alternators, and faulty plug wires. Even on our setup, Cody, and we like did a good job, like took our time, wrapped every wire. Yeah. Everything was hidden. I had an RF interference problem when I got home. I had a fan that would not behave, and I just could not understand why. And it was just because one wire was laying next to another wire. That's all it was. But that was the problem.
Yeah, and I know there's been people that have had trouble with using, especially if they're running older point style and older wiring and older coils, not a brand new coil.
Yeah.
The air cleaner stud itself acting as an antenna to pick up all the RFID.
Oh my gosh, is that right?
All the RFI under the hood. So. Yeah. I know there's some people that make some carbon fiber threaded studs, which seems excessive, but it's non-conductive in the way that they're built.
It's excessive until you've been through a world of suck trying to solve that problem.
Basically, every time I've sold one of these, and I've installed, I don't know, 10 or so, every time I do one of these, I pretty much tell the customers we need to do the whole system. Because if you're not going to do the whole system, you're not really seeing the benefits of the whole system. And you usually have some 30, 40-year-old HEI distributor whose vacuum advance isn't dialed in and the mechanical advance isn't dialed in anyway. So we might as well just throw the sniper distributor at it in the box anyway. Mm-hmm. So I've avoided a lot of problems in the systems that I've done by just telling people, yes, it is self-tuning to a point. I can get it dialed in, you know, within an hour or so of where it runs pretty good. But then after that, like kind of need to take it to a dyno to really get everything dialed in, to really get the maximum potential out of it. You've got to know enough about the system to know when something's going on. So that's kind of been my thing. And I know you, when we did the general early on, you know, that was one of the things you really liked to do, was to go into the weeds and make changes and see what it did.
Yeah.
So that's something when I have people that are like, oh, we're going to put fuel injection on it, and then I can just hit the key and drive away. And it's like, yes. But wait, there's more.
I have enjoyed, and like, I never took the EFI class. I would love to, but I have enjoyed tinkering with that and playing with it. And I have it to the point where it's a wonderful driving car, to the point it's boring. Mm-hmm. It works so well. Mm-hmm. The other component about this that I'm very interested in is the power distribution module. I don't have any experience with these systems, but I want to understand it. That sounds really slick.
That's what we always ran in our professional level road racing stuff, and even in some of our club racing level stuff that we've done. And we do that, honestly, not a full PDM, but even when we're doing our overland builds on our Toyotas and trucks that come through the shop, if we're adding more than like two circuits for lighting and refrigerators and whatever else is going on, inverters and all that, I buy a switch panel system, like an S-Pod or a Switch Pro or something along those lines. Because it's internally regulated, it's internally relayed. Some of them have fuses, some of them are self-resetting, just kind of depends on the budget. But going to a PDM in a vintage car, even on a, you know, like I say, a club level, not a motorsport level, F1 level stuff, it's such a leap beyond dealing with relays and fuses and all that kind of crap. It's just so much cleaner of an install. Mm-hmm. And then when you have a problem, you know, it's easy to figure it out.
Is it more easy to just diagnose?
Check it. I'm a big fan of that. I think that's a great way to bring higher level motorsport electronics and technology to the DIY guy in his garage. Yeah. I mean, it's awesome.
I've reached out to them. We're going to get somebody on probably the muscle car place for an in-depth interview. There are 14 new features in this, and I've only told you about the two that stuck out to me. Go to holley.com, check out the new product section. You can learn more about it. And I'm sure we will learn all about it when we go to MOParty. We will get the full rundown, inside out, backwards and forwards. It does come in different colors. I prefer gold. That's more my style. They have one that looks like a carburetor. I always prefer one that looks like a carburetor. I know it's not a carburetor. I don't care. I think the bowls look cool. I think they're super cool.
When you get a bit older, Rob, are you going to get a gold toothy up in front, you know, that matches your Holley unit, and then maybe let them paint the word Holley on that front toothy right there? So when you smile,
Yeah.
The world knows who you are.
Up next is the movie review that Holley has presented. This is called Hot Rod, released in the theaters August 3rd, 2007. That's a no, Burn.
No!
Directed by Akiva Schaffer. Written by Pam Brady, produced by John Goldwyn and Lorne Michaels of Saturday Night Live fame, starring Andy Samberg, Isla Fisher, Jorma Taccone, Bill Hader, Danny McBride, Sissy Spacek, Ian McShane, and here is the preview of the movie from the theater right here.
You're a terrible stuntman.
What?
You're a terrible stuntman!
I'm just kidding. I can hear you. It was just really mean.
Paramount Pictures.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a jump for the ages. The moment we've all been waiting for.
He's going in circles!
Andy Samberg.
Who wants to see me do a big stunt?
Hot Rod.
All great men have mustaches.
Yeah, but real men actually grow them, huh?
You know I have a hormone disorder!
Ooh.
Movie magic, right? Code. There is so much to love about this movie. This is a pop culture and automotive podcast. It's supposed to be. But you know what our man Corndog would have loved?
What's that, Rob?
He likes the stunts. He's mostly in it for the stunts. He likes the stunt man. And it talks about the stunts.
And the ramps.
So it's Evil Could Evil. It's not movie stunts, but it's stunts. It's big, bad movie stunts. As told by Andy Samberg, complete with 4 minute long knockdown drag out fights, just random hip thrusting by an Asian guy, 3 foot leaps of pedal start dirt bikes. Evil Knievel, if he were still alive, he would endorse it. He'd grow a mustache. I loved this movie. I know you have a review coming up here, but Burn, did you watch the movie?
I watched it almost completely twice. I'm going to be dead honest here. The first time I watched it, the first 45 minutes, I hated it.
Was it too weird for you?
I loathed it. I thought, this is so moronic. This is lower than some of the other great stuff that we've talked about. This is just, I don't like this. And then suddenly a switch went off and I started thinking back to my old days about, you know, what does it take to make a movie like this? It takes a lot more work to make a movie like this and pull it off than it does to make A Few Good Men or some other movie you think would be really, really great. And it started growing on me. And when I watched it again, I'm in love. This is one of my go-tos. In fact, I have pulled a clip. The next time we do a Kibbe and Friends intro, version 78 or whatever it is, I have the clip for myself that's going to go into that intro. And I'm not going to spoil it now. I'm sure we'll hit it later on in the review. But I pulled two, and one of those is going to end up in the new Kibbe and Friends intro whenever that happens.
I'm sure we've got an idea. It's probably AM radio themed. This one, I don't know when I saw this movie the first time. I don't remember that. I've pulled a lot of interesting just movie facts and trivia that I want to throw by to you guys to see if you remember when this came out. But it's so clever in how it's presented. I can't imagine it not being beloved. It wasn't. It was a box office failure. I love all the little weird clips where Andy Samberg says, I've got to have a plan. And then he spends the next 5 minutes explaining his plan to us, the audience, from like a Zamboni, telling us each detail that will occur throughout the process here. So here's the IMDb summary. IMDb summary says, Rod Kimball is a naive slacker living in a small U.S. town with his mom, his younger brother, and a stepfather whose respect he craves. He also misses his dead father, whom he thinks was Evil Knievel's backup. Rod, a man-child, believes that he is a stuntman. When his stepfather needs an operation, with the help of his brother and slacker pals, Rod hatches a plan to set a school bus jumping record on his moped. This is a very long summary. First, his crew and he have to raise money to rent buses and build a ramp. Trouble is, Rod's inept at his chosen career. Looming failure is complicated by the return of Denise, Rod's next-door neighbor and secret heartthrob, who is home from college. Is public humiliation at hand? Question mark. End of summary. It's a very long summary. Now, Cody's going to do a summary. Here's the Wikipedia summary, though. Hot Rod is a 2007 American comedy film directed by Akiva Schaffer in his directorial debut. The film stars Andy Samberg as an amateur stuntman named Rod Kimball, whose stepfather, Frank, continuously mocks and disrespects him. When Frank becomes ill, Rod raises money for his heart operation by executing his largest stunt yet. That's fine.
Technically, it's okay, but I think Cody's is going to be a lot better.
I'm interested. Cody, I didn't summarize it at all. I thought you would anyway. I hope you don't mind. But what is the Cody crafted Cody Young of you Cody YouTube fame summary of this movie?
Well, if you think that review was long, tighten your seatbelt.
I'm ready.
Well, my name is Cody, and I like to party. You shitheads, I just found out one of the funniest movies of all time. Would you like to light it off with me? Violence, substance abuse, alcohol use, smoking, foul language, and sexual content. This film could only be better if they had actually put Voltron in it. Even so, it is still super badass. The IMDb summary that I found says, self-proclaimed stuntman Rob Kimball is preparing for the jump of his life to clear 15 buses to raise money for his abusive stepfather's life-saving heart operation. And that's like saying ice cream is just really cold milk. The movie is such a comedic masterpiece, firing on all of its mustache-fueled cylinders like Clay Milliken at Vandermeer. Mm. Written by Pam Brady, who penned such icons as South Park, Bigger, Longer, Uncut, and Team America, World Police.
Really?
You may have heard of these. Yeah. Before there were memes, before Bernie was on the news, actually, no, Bernie was still on the news. There was a time when we just sat around cranking out one-liners from movies to make each other laugh. Like many other Lorne Michaels works, this film is one of those that is just chock full. The delivery by the SNL cast and writing alums, Andy Samberg, Chris Parnell, Bill Hader, Dorman Tacone, Kevin, and the director, Akiva Schiffer, brings everyone to the lonely island with totem spirits and safe words for street luge. The crew has a new mission beyond goofing around as an amateur stuntman when Rod's stepfather is revealed to be in need of a heart transplant. Rod sets out to cure Frank so he can then beat him to death to prove his manhood. Isla Fisher plays the absolute perfect girl next door. Mm-hmm. Lego Batman is her D-bag boyfriend. Stefan the club kid is a master wrench. Kenny Powers himself builds the best ramps in America, and my safe word is whiskey. I have an addendum to Bernie's news segment. AM radio is back. No TV coverage allowed, but the eloquent auditory picture just might be enough to raise those funds to save Frank. This is a truly hilarious film. There's not any given one-minute segment that is not an absolute giggle fest. My family and I have literally been quoting this one for 15 years, and on my deathbed, I will remind you that I am still too legit to quit. Movie review, nailed it.
Yes!
10 stars. You're hired.
Awesome.
Was channeling my best Finnegan.
It had a very Finnegan-esque weave to it.
I had to do what I could.
It is a truly hilarious movie. I didn't see it in the theater. Did you see it in the theater, Cody?
I did not, and I regret that every day.
I had to do a little homework here. So Andy Samberg, I knew him from Saturday Night Live. I didn't know anything about the Lonely Island troupe. So it's he, Akiva Schaffer, who's the director of this, and Jorma Tacone. Who I think is one of the other actors in this movie, right?
It's Kevin.
That's his brother?
Yeah, Kevin.
Okay.
Well, plays his brother, yeah.
They're from Berkeley, California. They had their own comedy troupe. According to the internet, it says the three of them met in junior high. After graduating from college, they regrouped and moved to Los Angeles. They struggled to find work, began making short films, combined absurdist comedy and occasional music, found their way to Saturday Night Live.
Then they recruited Justin Timberlake and stuck their junk in boxes.
So if you like Dick in a Box, that's from Lonely Island. There are many more songs that I'm not going to say because I found out my kids listen to this show. But I will assure you, any short that you saw with Andy Samberg on Saturday Night Live was a result of Lonely Island. They have another movie called Pop Star Never Stop, Never Stoppin', which I also adore. Not as much as Hot Rod. It's different. It's this great comedy troupe. They work really well together. And for whatever reason, this kind of comedy just clicks with me. I understand it. I get it. Like, I anticipate the next joke. I can't wait when it gets there. And the sound mixing in this one is just outstanding. Bern, I'm going to play you a couple of clips. You just give me a rating from 1 to 10 on the quality of the sound mixing, which we can do here on an audio show. Here's the first one here, Byrne.
Oh! Oh!
I can see it.
I show that to my son when he's sad, and he's always happy afterwards.
Yeah, there's lots going on in that. That's some good sound design right there, because the scene is our hero is rolling down a forested rocky hill. And so there's a lot of innuendo that plays in about the sound and the environment, which is critical to good sound design. So you have a lot of left to right panning. So you're coming across the screen and following. You have distance and close up elements. You have the punches, you know, where he's hitting the ground and hits the tree. All of those are very subtle changes. And most of those are different. So you can tell the difference in them. A lot going on there. Great, great job.
That even somehow capture it, you know, in 2D TV with him flying overhead, spinning, and you hear the when he hits things. And as we all do, you hit it so hard, you cry, yell, and then you hit the next one, and the next one, and the next one. I'll give you one more clip here, Byrne. This is something that almost didn't make the movie, and it was found to be too odd and too weird. But this was an edit of some dialogue that they turned into a song. Let's try this one.
Cool beans.
Cool beans.
Cool beans.
Cool beans.
Cool beans.
Cool beans.
Cool, cool.
Beans.
Beans.
Cool.
Beans.
Cool, cool.
Beans.
Beans.
Cool.
Beans.
Cool, cool.
Beans.
Beans.
Cool.
Beans.
Cool.
Beans.
Cool.
Cool. Beans.
Beans.
Cool.
It's genius level stuff.
Guys, my face is red and I can't breathe just listening to these because I love this movie so much.
That's awesome. Welcome to the late 80s, early 90s. And a character you may remember from the Coca-Cola commercials, Max Headroom, that kind of made that famous on TV. Rap and street music was in its infancy then. And so that was all the rage. Just a great job. Editing there is just fantastic. The back and forth cuts and then the sound dubbing in like that. Just beautiful. Yeah, genius level. Absolutely.
You're about to make tears come out of my face.
This type of editing in here. So the director, he's part of the Lonely Island troupe. Let me grab his name again because it's not a name I know. Akiva Schaefer. I think he has a lot to do with the way this is cut. Seeing his style is probably why the shorts on Saturday Night Live look like they do. They were so popular to the point where they got spoofed on The Office. And The Office made shorts that looked like these. So here's the quick summary of the movie. Rod Kimball is a stuntman. He believes his dad was a stuntman. He believes wrongly. His dad worked at a tire shop, and he got a picture with Evel Knievel, and his dad died young. And Rod just believed that his dad was a stuntman and always wanted to be one. And he wants to be a stuntman now. So he performs crazy Evel Knievel stunts. But instead of a Harley Davidson, he has like a pedal start moped that like burns fuel and oil simultaneously. He cannot grow a mustache. So whenever he performs stunts, he puts a false one on. He has a crew of beloved idiots that support him. He's got his stepbrother. Who's the guy who builds all the ramps? The best ramps of all?
Rico.
He's got Rico. And then he's got Bill Hader. Rico. What's Bill Hader's name in the movie?
Dave.
Dave is probably my favorite. Like,
yes.
Dave works at the ice rink, and a coworker of Dave's came up and said, "Hey, I've got some acid and I can't take it." And he goes, "Well, okay, I guess I can do it." And
I'll take it. And then I was on my bench grinder.
And the next thing, you know what? I've got this piece of metal in my eye. But the trauma of the movie, Rod's stepdad has, actually, I don't know what's wrong. A heart issue, probably?
It's a heart condition, and he needs $50,000 for a conveniently priced surgery.
Exactly 50 grand to replace the heart. So he's going to do a stunt, and that's going to be how he raises funds to help his stepdad, a man who does not seem to like him, but he desperately wants to earn the respect of. That's the movie. The neighbor, though, is Isla Fisher, and she is just a stunningly good-looking next-door neighbor. And she is a college student, for some reason, joins his crew over the summer to help him. And that's the gist of the movie. And they end up falling in love. Her boyfriend, like you said, is Lego Batman. Will Arnett.
Arnett, yeah.
Will Arnett is so good in this as well.
And these are my ladies.
Will doesn't have a huge component in this movie, but he is outstanding. So I went and grabbed some production notes. So Hot Rod, written by Pam Brady, like you said. This was originally a project for Will Ferrell. Did you know that?
He actually was an EP on it. Yeah, he was a producer, executive producer on it still.
I did not know that. They rewrote it for the Lonely Island crew to make that happen. Lauren Michaels helped push it through.
I could totally see that. Totally see it. Because what other movie does this harken back to? What other movie that we love, you know, has overtones in this? Step Brothers.
Well, and Ricky Bobby.
Yeah. Ricky Bobby is the one I was thinking of. Yeah, tell that again.
Yeah.
All over it. Yeah.
Largely shot in Vancouver in the summer of 2006. Shooting locations included Cloverdale, British Columbia, other various locations. Sandberg had a stunt double, but did as many stunts of his own that he was allowed.
They made it halfway into the pool. That was awesome.
My favorite is when they hit him with the refrigerator.
That's beautiful. It's just awesome. That's something you would almost go out and try with that much padding on.
Oh, yeah.
It received mixed reviews from film critics upon initial release. On Metacritic, it has an average rating of 43 out of 100. On Rotten Tomatoes, it has a score of 39%.
Oh, that's ridiculous.
It is terribly scored. But then you get to some movie reviewers that typically hate things like this that liked it, including Roger Ebert. Roger Ebert was still alive. He gave it 3 out of 4 stars. And here's his review. He said, "This movie is funny because it is sincere. The movie likes Rod. It doesn't portray him as a maniacal goofball, but as an ambitious kid who really thinks every single time that he will succeed. In creating this aura of sincerity, Hot Rod benefits from Spacek's performance. She plays the mom absolutely straight, without inflection, as if she were not in a comedy. That's the only right choice. Supporting characters are needed to reinforce Rod, not compete with him." Roger Ebert liked this movie.
That's awesome.
I can't believe that.
You know, really, kudos to the casting director on this one. That must be such an awesome job to be a casting director, because you get to go through your portfolio of people and get to invite people like Sissy Spacek to do a show like this, who just nailed it, just absolutely nailed the mom. I mean, the dress, the mannerisms, the makeup and or lack of makeup, just the interaction to in the family at the table when she's telling our hero about his real dad, the tissue wrapped around her thumb, just as a mom would do in that setting. Just beautifully done.
Ian McShane is his stepdad. I think of Ian McShane as a serious actor. I can't actually think of
like
him
a in a badass.
I can't think of him like in another comedy role. He's very intimidating.
He played a big badass in Death Race. Remember, he was the main that's crew right. guy.
Yeah, he was Well, he was in Pirates of the Caribbean. Of course, John Wick. Mm-hmm. I love him in that one.
Do you guys follow the motorcycles well? I don't know a lot about motorcycles. What is, not the motorcycle that he jumps at the end, but the pedal start moped? What is that thing?
So that is a moped. Like, if it didn't have pedals, then it would be a scooter, right? So a moped is a motorized pedal bike. Mm-hmm. And they're usually like 50cc and two-stroke or smaller. Then sometimes they're smaller than that. They don't have enough torque to get them going without actually pedaling. So I had one as a kid.
Oh, yeah.
At my great uncle's house, we used to have one out there. We just go out and rode around. And then I upgraded to the Honda Express 50. It didn't have pedals. It was just a two-stroke.
Do you remember how it started? Did you have to pedal to start it?
You had to pedal it to start it. Yeah,
there was a scene where he kicked it and it started it, and I couldn't remember if that was right or not. Well,
some of them. The one we had didn't have a kickstart, but the one in the movie, he does have a kickstart. Yeah,
okay.
The soundtrack is outstanding. It is the music that a stuntman would listen to. Bern, you're going to find a little piece in your folder right here. The soundtrack was composed by ex-Yest guitarist Trevor Rabin. Several songs by the Swedish rock band Europe are in the movie, including Cherokee and Rock the Night. The trailer contains 3 Swedish songs, Europe's Cherokee and the Final Countdown, and the Hives' See Through Head. It also includes the UK rock band Test Icicle's Circle Square. Circle Square Triangle, as well as American Hi-Fi's The Art of Losing. The band called Gown that plays Rod's final jump is actually Queens of the Stone Age. What's the song that plays when he's doing his rage dance scene? So after he has the fight with his stepfather, he goes out into the forest and dances like Footloose style to Rage, but ends up doing gymnastics to the Never, 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 that song.
Never, never, never.
And finds like a
pum horse.
The pum horse.
So there was a movie with, was it Charlie Sheen, where he was a gymnast? I mean, obviously you had the Footloose, but there was another one where Charlie Sheen went out into the like the woods to do a similar thing.
To rage dance to gymnastic moves?
I need to go to my quiet place.
The reason it's so wonderful is because halfway through his gymnastic moves, he trips over a tree trunk and falls down a mountain for 5 minutes. Lord, it's good.
Simpson did it.
Here's the box office for 2007. So this movie had a budget of roughly $25 million. At the box office, it did 14. It was a fail financially. Mm-hmm. Now, I'd be curious to see how it has done ever since. I bought this movie just to watch it. You know, I rented it for 2 days. I'll rent it again. But at that time, it lost $9 million. In 2007, out of the top 200 grossing movies, it came in at 141. You guys want to go through the top 10 from 2007?
Sure.
The Simpsons movie was number 10 at 183 million.
I saw that one.
I Am Legend number 9 at 200 million. Number 8, Ratatouille. I love that movie. 206.5 million. Seventh place, the movie 300, 210.6 million. Number 6, The Bourne Ultimatum, 227.4 million. Number 5, Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix, 292 million. Number 4, Pirates of the Caribbean, A World's End, 309 million. Transformers in third place, 319 million. Shrek the Third at second place, $223 million. And number 1, Spider-Man 3, $336.5 million. Hot Rod did $14 million.
The critics did not like the Blues Brothers either. And now it's a major piece of fabric in Americana. So take your review and go smoke it. That's what I say.
So it's funny you say that. That's where we're going to end before a surprisingly appropriate brand new game. Lorne Michaels himself said this about this movie. He says, I've lived through everything from Wayne's World with Mike Myers to Tommy Boy with Chris Farley, all the things I did with Will Ferrell, even Three Amigos. Critics just don't like new comedians, and they certainly don't like them if they come from Saturday Night Live or television. Later on, they revise their opinions and say that so-and-so's later films aren't as good as the first ones. I think this picture will be thought of differently in just 2 years.
Nuts. He might know a thing or two about young comedians.
He might just know. So would you guys like to end with our brand new game called Is This Clip from Hot Rod or Not?
I don't know how I can sleep tonight without it, Rob.
Now, Bern, you've only seen this movie a couple of times today. You're going up against a master here in Cody. Yeah. I did my best to cloud this as best I could. So these all are going to be pretty appropriate, but you got to tell me, is this from Hot Rod or not? And if it's not, you got to tell me what it's from. That's how it works.
By pretty appropriate, do you mean completely inappropriate?
I'm trying to trick you.
That's French for I'm making this up as I go along.
Okay. We will start with Cody, and I know that the game show music is already playing. Cody, you are up first. Here we go.
Yoo-hoo, shitheads. I just found a bag of fireworks in the men's restroom. Would you guys like to light them off?
I wonder if you'll get that one. I'm concerned. Do you need to phone a friend, or do you think you got it?
If only Corndog was here.
Yeah.
Yes, this is absolutely spoken by Rico himself. Bang!
You are correct. Put yourself down for 2 points already. Okay. Over here to Burn. Now, Burn, again, I'm trying to trick you. This could have been in here, or it might not have been. Let's see if you were paying attention. Sounds like something from what's the name of their troop again? The Silent
Legend. The Lonely Island.
Sounds like it could be from Lonely Island, but was it from this movie, Burn?
This is a trick question, no doubt, because there's appropriate crowd sounds in the background, like we're doing something. I was kind of picturing the street scene, but that's not the right music for the street scene where they're chorusing through, walking down to the event. You may have me on this one, but I'm going to say yes.
Oh, you fail. It is not. That is from a Saturday Night Live short clip, which is called Lazy Sunday. That was probably the first breakthrough hit of the Lonely Island Troupe on SNL. No problem. No problem, Bernie. You've got plenty more options to come.
Shake it off.
Over here to Cody. This is a 30-second clip, Cody. You got to hear the whole thing or you might get it wrong. So don't jump in early.
Oh, darn.
So one afternoon, he set out to jump 10 milk trucks. He nailed the takeoff. But when he landed, something terrible happened. His front tire exploded like a cannonball, and his handlebars went straight through his head. Blood was everywhere. His teeth were ground down to a powder, and the front of his face exploded out the back of his skull. He died instantly.
He died instantly.
The next day.
The next day.
What do you think, Cody? Now that could be any Andy Samberg movie, but what do you think? Was that from this movie, Hot Rod?
That would absolutely be from Hot Rod.
You are in the lead. Put yourself down for another couple of points. I don't know, Burn. He might be pulling away from you.
He might be.
We'll go to Burn here. Short one here, Burn. Let's see if you can get this.
I'm not saying that kiss was hot, listeners, but if the boner police are here, I demand a lawyer.
Okay, Burn. I picked the one I thought whose voice you'd appreciate.
Absolutely. That is from the movie, yeah.
Bang! And just for bonus points, maybe catch up on your 2 points, was that your AM radio hero?
That was my AM radio hero. He was broadcasting live on AM radio from the event.
Very good.
We call them remotes in the day.
Yes. Just a couple to go here. Let's do this one. All right, Cody. Is this one from this movie or not?
My safe word will be whiskey.
Sorry, Rod. What was that?
Whiskey.
So you mean whiskey?
What?
You're saying it weird.
Saying what weird?
Saying what weird?
Hold it.
Where do you get off?
I just don't get why you're saying it that way.
Why I'm saying what way?
What forget way?
It. I will forget it.
What do you think, Code? Was that from this movie or not? Hot Rod.
Those of you listening at home, this is a laugh of pure joy. I've literally not been this happy since my children were born.
So, yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah, I'm sorry. It's just it's so good.
All right, Bern. I can't remember if you got bonus points last time. I think you did. So if you get this right, it's a perfect cake tie. So, Bern, is this clip, this final clip from this movie or not?
One. Cut a hole in a box. Put your junk in that box.
What do you think, Bird?
Oh, man.
Excellent music. Could easily be from this movie. But is it?
But easily not also.
Seems like a Christmas song almost.
Man.
Or Hanukkah. Or Easter.
Kwanzaa.
Kwanzaa.
What do you think, Bird? Remember, you're on an automotive and pop culture podcast. So for the automotive fans listening who have learned the true definition of a moped... Was that from the movie Hot Rod?
You know, it sounds so much like the crowd scene inside the movie theater, but I wasn't paying that close attention to the music. I mean, the crowd sounds right. I'm going to say yes.
Oh, poor Bird. No, that was from the Saturday Night Live short clip, Dick in a Box, where where the perfect gift for your lady was what the song says. So there we go. That concludes our brand new game. Was that from Hot Rod or not? A perfect cake champion in Cody Young of Cody Crafted of YouTube fame. Way absolutely. To go.
You know, I'm the king of the world on a boat like Leo. If you own the show, then your show ain't me, yo. No, you guys overheard that one?
I have not.
It's another Lonely Island song. It's the, I'm on a boat. You know,
I think I do know that song.
I got my swim trunks and my flippy floppies. I'm on the deck flicking burgers. Yes. You can't go straight flipping copies. Yeah.
Yes, I do know that one now. Well, with that said, we have come to the conclusion of our show. I think I already gave this a rating. What was your rating for this movie, Cody? Out of 10 corn dogs, 10 Justin Cornette corn dogs, how many would you give it?
I give it 10 two-stroke bus jumping motocross corn dogs.
Outstanding. How about you, Bern? What's your rating?
Oh, easily. It's a 10. Easily 10 corn dogs. Not only was it a great movie, I've picked up some new favorite phrases from the film I'm going to carry with me. Would you like me to share what they are?
Yes, please.
Please.
Oh, I'm looking forward to it.
Some of my new favorite phrases, not necessarily in this order, but close. One, of course, cool beans. Never used that phrase enough, but now we're going to. We're going to back incorporate that a little bit. Life is short, stunted, an amazingly good pool.
That is a good
awesome.
One.
Yeah. He choked on some pie. There will be occasion to use he choked on some pie in our future, so I'm going to keep that one in my back pocket. I do laundry with no pants on. Man, that hits home, doesn't it? That's right down the old Burns bowling alley. You betcha. More about FM and color TV. Yeah, that's something I can live with. I can take that in my wallet and keep it with me. Not so sure about this one, but there's got to be room for... No, babe, wait. Wait, babe. Babe, wait. There's
got to
be...
No.
No.
No, no.
Babe.
One I picked out for Cody, he can use this. If he doesn't already, who am I supposed to build ramps for?
Who am I supposed to build ramp for now?
I give this one a perfect 10 as well. It is a perfectly cast movie. I can't imagine this with Will Ferrell in it. I love it as it is. I don't want it any other way. I freaking love it.
I don't know that you could swap any of the main characters. It just wouldn't be the same. Like, the casting is so perfect.
And whenever I see Danny McBride in anything else, I think of him in this. It makes me happy.
Every time I grab a bottle of green tea, I think I'm going to beat some old man.
I've been drinking green tea all day. Why do they beat up someone who they have harmed? That's the funniest part about it.
That's what does it. This is totally my hat. I love that, like, way too often.
Well, that's it. We're going to wrap this one out. Everybody, thank you for listening. Let us know what you think of our very loose automotive show. This review, thank God there was at least something with a motor in it, because that was about the only automotive we had in it, but it was well worth doing. And it is heavy on stunts. And the movies we like with cars typically are heavy on the stunts. As our corndog would say, it's got some good stunts and some good pictures. That's what I think.
That's right.
You can leave us a rating on Apple Podcasts. You can find us in all the popular places. Make sure that you visit Holley. Check out all the details on the new Sniper, and we'll get a feature interview with them soon. Burn, anything before we go?
No, I think this is self-encapsulated, and I'll just leave it as.
Code, how about you?
Dang it, I have about 15 in the back of my mind here, but I'm going to leave you with, or you could cut the kitty stuff and show me the craft yourself move.
It didn't work. I'm just going to leave that.
Totally didn't work. I'm well.
All right, fellas. Thank you as always. Holley, thank you for the sponsorship. Corndog, you missed a good one. See you later, Cody Young and Cody Kids. Thanks for listening, everybody. Bye-bye.
Later.
Bye.
The Kibbe and Friends Show, brought to you by our good friends at Holley Performance. Click the link on our show page and visit holley.com for everything air, fuel, and performance related for your ride. Connect with us on the socials and at patreon.com/KAFS. See you next week. Later on.
Yoo-hoo, shitheads. I just found a bag of fireworks in the men's restroom. Would you guys like to light them off?
All great men have mustaches, Frank.
Yeah, but real men actually grow them, huh?
No, I have a hormone disorder!
Ooh. I'm not saying that kiss was hot, listeners, but if the boner police are here, I demand a lawyer.
So one afternoon, he set out to jump 10 milk trucks. He nailed the takeoff, but when he landed, something terrible happened. His front tire exploded like a cannonball, and his handlebars went straight through his head. Blood was everywhere. His teeth were ground down to a powder, and the front of his face exploded out the back of his skull. He died instantly. The next day.
My safe word will be whiskey.
Sorry, Rod, what was that?
Whiskey.
So you mean whiskey?
What?
You're saying it weird.
Saying what weird?
All of it.
Where do you get off?
I just don't get why you're saying it that way.
Why I'm saying what way?
Forget it.
I will forget it.
Cut a hole in a box. Put your junk in that box. Make her open the box.